What are the phases of AML treatment?
So we can divide this up into the induction treatment phase, and then consolidation, and then maintenance. So three sort of different compartments as far as the phases of AML treatment. So as far as induction treatment, one usually will give this for patients who have clear relapse of AML or newly diagnosed AML. So patients who have relapse will also classically be given high dose or intensive type of regimens if they can tolerate this. And again, that relates to age of the patient and their performance status, for instance, and comorbidities. So consolidation treatment is given once there is clearance of leukemia in the bone marrow to less than 5%, then one usually will give consolidation type treatment, which is also fairly intensive type chemotherapy. And some one of the drugs that's used for in virtually all situations of consolidation is the cytarabine or arabinoside, arabinoside. And so that drug is given either by itself in fairly high doses, or it's combined with another drug group called anthracyclines, like daunorubicin or idarubicin or others in that group. So they classically use for consolidation treatment. And usually it depends on the number of cycles that are administered depend on the patient's age and tolerability, et cetera, and performance status. But usually one will attempt to give at least two cycles of consolidation therapy. Some people give up to four cycles of consolidation therapy, but not all patients can tolerate those types of treatment, especially the older patients. So in them, we would usually then decide on using a lesser intensive type treatment often with hypermethylating agents, and which is the two common ones are Dacogen or Vidaza that we have today. But there are other agents coming along as well that hopefully will improve that the outcomes for patients as far as consolidation. And when once given consolidation, you try to get rid of any residual leukemic cells that may be present after they've had the intensive chemotherapy. It's very difficult to give repeated courses of intensive chemotherapy because they are very tough to get through from a patient from a symptomatic perspective with complications because of very low blood counts, low neutrophil counts and infections, low platelet counts and bleeding problems, etc., and requirement of transfusions. So when a patient is evaluated after they have had their intensive chemotherapy, usually the evaluation is done on day 28, but it may also be done, an initial marrow check would be done on day 14 to see if the blasts are cleared. But by around about day 28, with a week or two either side of that, usually a bone marrow is done to see if a patient's achieved remission. So when the definition for complete remission is there's less than 5% blasts in the bone marrow, the platelet count has risen to over 100,000, and the neutrophil count, that's part of it, it's one of the types of white cells that are very important in fighting bacterial infections and fungal infections, they are over 1,000. So, and the patient does not require any blood transfusions. That's what the classification is for complete remission. Then there's a complete complete remission that, but without complete recovery of either the neutrophils or the platelets. So CRI, you see that terminology, a CR and a little I. That's a complete remission, but with an incomplete blood count recovery. So in that situation, it's the same as there's less than 5% blasts always in the bone marrow, but the platelets or the neutrophils have not recovered to over 100,000 for platelets or over 1,000 for neutrophils. And the patient it will then be called incomplete remission. So when there's complete remission versus complete remission, but incomplete blood counts, that those patients, the CRI, incomplete recovery of counts, they usually do worse. It's a marker that this patient may not do as well as those who achieved a complete remission, because they have reasons, perhaps because as to why those blood counts haven't recovered, such as there may be underlying bone marrow dysfunction. Like it may suggest that a patient may have had a prior myelodysplastic syndrome. So there was already damage to the marrow before the leukemia occurred. Now there was damage from myelodysplastic syndrome, for instance. And now later on, we see the patient when they're in an acute leukemic phase with a newly diagnosed leukemia. So just some concepts around the phases of AML treatment, and also when we treat the patients, when we call complete remission or partial or complete remission with incomplete recovery. Then there's another term, partial remission, that we should just introduce. That's when we treat the patient, but they do not achieve a complete remission, but the blast count in the marrow has reduced by more than 50%. So if a patient's blast count, let's say, was 60% when their leukemia was diagnosed, and we treat them with intensive chemotherapy, for instance, and now we do a repeat bone marrow, and now the blast count is at 12%, so it's reduced by more than 50%. We call that a partial remission. It's not what we want to see. We want to see complete remission.